Good morning. Good to see you all. I was running a little late this morning, and I got a call from my old longtime friend Weldon Hohertz, who's right here on the second row. And he told me that somebody told him, I don't know if it was Larry or someone else, that if I didn't show up in the next 5 minutes that he was up. I thought, I've got to get there. You don't want that. No, just kidding. No, the reason I was running later than I intended to be is because some officer was kind enough to inform me that I was in violation of the law. No, actually I had a brake light was out, so he pulled me over and let me know all about that, and takes forever to check on everything, make sure I am legal, other than that. And so that's why I was running a little bit late for anybody who might have been concerned about that, other than Weldon. Well, New Testament church began as a very Jewish movement. At first, at least from the point of view of the Romans, the movement was nothing more than just another sect of Judaism or within Judaism. And as far as many other Jews were concerned, many of them didn't seem to have a problem with it. Some did, but some didn't, because many of the early Jewish Christians continued worshiping right there at the temple with the other Jews. But over time, all of this changed. More and more people who were not Jewish were converting to the faith. At first, it was the God-fearing Gentiles, people that the Jewish community were familiar with. They were not Jews. They had not submitted to circumcision, had not been adopted into the nation. They were considered Gentiles or non-Jews, and yet they were in many cases, they were respected by the Jewish community. But they began to convert, and then as time went on, many converts came in directly from the pagan world. And so the church, the culture within the church, began to change somewhat. And we began to see, or in the book of Acts, we began to see that there were cultural clashes taking place as a result of these different people with different cultural backgrounds, different approaches to things, being in the same congregations. Not only were there cultural clashes because customs were so different, but also a new question arose, and that question pertained to the identity of the people of God. Now you can imagine it, you can think about how it must have been for Jews who have converted to the faith. They've accepted Jesus as the Messiah, recognizing Him as the one prophesied in Scripture to be the Messiah, and know that He, through Him, the new covenant is instituted, that the new covenant pertains to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. So you can imagine what it must be like for them as these great numbers of non-Jews begin coming into the faith, and they're not converting to Judaism first. They're coming into the faith, and they are still non-Jews. They remain uncircumcised. And so when you read Acts chapter 15, that's the background. That's the problem that was going on there. And this is also what was in mind when Paul wrote to the Romans, because he wrote to a church that was partly Jewish and partly Gentile. And the various house churches that made up the church in Rome, they didn't have a big cathedral then. They had just house churches. And you had congregations, probably some were all Jewish, some were probably all Greek or Roman or whatever, Gentile, and others were mixed. And you had the different customs and the different approach to things, and so you had the cultural clash going on there. And that's in the backdrop of the book of Romans. Now today, with all this in mind, I want to focus on one verse in the book of Romans. We'll look at some other verses, but right now let's take a look at one verse. It's in Romans, the 4th chapter, and in verse 13. And I can see now that I ran off and left something that may slow me down a little bit in my reading, but my reading glasses. In Romans chapter 4 and verse 13, fortunately I have this one written down because I wanted to use the Revised Standard Version. It says, "The promise to Abraham and his descendants," translated also seed or offspring, different depending on the translation you're using, "the promise to Abraham and his descendants that they should inherit the world did not come through the law, but through the righteousness of faith." Now, when we come to a passage like this, we tend to read it through the lenses of the issues that are important to us. But those issues that are important to us, the issues that characterize the debates in the Christian world today, may not have been in view when Paul wrote that. For example, we look at this, say, yes, this is the law and grace or the law and faith thing, the subject. You know, law versus works, or I should say grace or faith versus works. Yeah, that's in there, but it's really, there's more to it. There's a lot more to it than just that. Paul has this cultural clash in the backdrop, and he has this dichotomy of Jew and Gentile making up, Jews and Gentiles making up one congregation. And now they've got to get along together, and they've got to sort through some things, and you have to deal with the question regarding the identity of God. But again, you can imagine what it must have been like for a Jew who all his life had been told, you're the chosen people, we are the chosen people. Who are the chosen people? The Jews are the chosen people. So they got the message, chosen people. And now then they're in congregations with believing Gentiles, and we're told, they are too. What? Really? How's that? So anyway, that's some of the issues that they were having to sort through. But for us, we might look at this and think, yes, this is the faith versus works issue. Well, yeah, we can look through what Paul says here in Romans, as the Reformers did, and we can comment on faith and works. But Paul had the broader issue in the backdrop. Also, we can look at the promise. He says that the promise was inheritance of the world. And an issue for us today is, yeah, you see right there, it says they inherit the world. There's no going to heaven in that passage. No going to heaven when you die. So that's an issue for us today, because practically the whole of Christendom, or many, I'll put it this way, in many Christian denominations, you hear it over and over and over again, the goal is to get to heaven. And then when you look at the New Testament, you don't see that. You see that it's inheritance of the world, inheritance of the earth. The goal is transformation here in this life, or transformation here on this earth, and not fleeing off to some other place. But here again, that's an issue that's important to us. When we do that, when we read the scriptures that way, and I'm not saying we shouldn't read the scriptures and use them to address issues that are important to us, but when we do that, we may be missing what the issue of that day really was. We might be missing it, and why Paul says what he says. In fact, we sometimes focus on incidental terms and phrases within a passage and make that the subject of the passage, when in fact it is not. It is not. It may address it to some extent, but it's not the subject. Now we'll come back to verse 13. In a few moments, because there's something that I want to call your attention to in it. But to get a picture of the larger situation here, go to Acts chapter 21. Acts chapter 21, this is when Paul and his team went to Jerusalem. Excuse me. They went to Jerusalem. They met with James and the elders. And we read, beginning in verse 19, when he had greeted them, he told in detail those things which God had done among the Gentiles through his ministry. Now here was the reaction of James and the elders in Jerusalem. When they heard it, they glorified the Lord. Well, that's a good reaction, because remember, Acts 15 has already happened. The conference has already happened. And so they understand what is going on and how God is dealing not just with the Jews, but with the Gentiles as well. And they said to him, "You see, brother, how many myriads of Jews there are who have believed, and they are all zealous for the law." Do you get that? They're all zealous for the law. What does that mean? Thank you. Got a little tad of bronchitis or something going on here. So here's the point. You have all these Gentiles in the church. Now you have these Jews. Look around Jerusalem. What do you see? All the believing Jews. Myriads of them. Too many to count. And they're all zealous for the law. Now how would you know they were zealous for the law? Aren't we all supposed to be zealous for the law? Well, there's a limited meaning to this. Yeah, we all should be zealous for the law, if by the law you mean like the Ten Commandments, the law, love your neighbor as yourself, the law, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and so on and so on. But what he's talking about here very clearly in context is the ritual law, because he has Paul, James has Paul, go to the temple and participate in the Nazirite vow, the shaving of these four men, they were under a vow, it's a Nazirite vow, and Paul was going to participate with them in the sacrifice. And what a Nazirite did when his vow was finished, then he'd cut off his hair and burn it along with the sacrifice that was offered. So Paul was going to participate with them and show them he's not against the law or against the temple and so on, as the rumor had said. So that's what's going on here. Now, it goes on to say, verse 25, but concerning the Gentiles, well, let's start in verse 24. It says, take them and be purified with them and pay their expenses. You know, he did that. He'd probably get on their good side. So that they may shave their heads, and that all may know that those things of which they were informed concerning you are nothing, and that you yourself also walk orderly and keep the law. There's that expression. Now, what does that mean? Obviously, it's talking about the law as it pertains to things regarding the temple, the rituals, and so on. Things you could see people doing. That's how they knew that all these believing Jews were zealous for the law, because they could see them participating in the temple ritual. But then he goes on to say, verse 25, but concerning the Gentiles who believe, we have written and decided that they should observe no such thing, except that they should keep themselves from things offered to idols. This is back in Acts chapter 15, the same things that are mentioned there. From blood, from things strangled, and from sexual immorality, or porneia, very broad meaning there. Now, a little side note here. Have you noticed that it says nothing here about keeping the fourth commandment? No Sabbath? Doesn't say a thing about Sabbath, does it? But for that matter, it doesn't say anything about taking God's name in vain, doesn't say anything about honoring parents, doesn't say anything about bearing false witness or covetousness. So obviously, these were things that needed to be addressed, but it doesn't mean this is your total responsibility. Some people seem to think that that was their total responsibility, but no, they were required to put away covetousness. They were supposed to not bear false witness, and they were supposed to honor their parents. Ephesians 5, for example, that's what Paul says there. And so the commandments of God, he's not talking about the moral law. He's talking about this ritual law. So that's, you have that in the backdrop. One set of people walking according to the customs, very different culturally than this other set of people. Put them together in one congregation, there are going to be some clashes, and there's going to be some things to sort through. So that's what was going on. Now back to Romans chapter 4 and verse 13. Again, the promise to Abraham and his descendants that they should inherit the world did not come through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. Now, here's the thing we might miss. What do you mean, inherit the world? Since when was Abraham promised that he would inherit the world? I thought there was a specific piece of land that he was to inherit, and his descendants after him were to inherit. Where does it say, and how did we come to this, that Abraham and his descendants were to inherit the world? Well, look at Genesis chapter 12. Let's review the promise very briefly and see what it actually says. Genesis chapter 12 and in verse 1. Now the Lord said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. Now he's leaving one place to go to a land that God is going to show him. Drop down to verse 5, the latter part of verse 5. The very last sentence in verse 5, and they departed to go to the land of Canaan, so they came to the land of Canaan. So where was this land that God was going to show to Abraham? It was in a place called Canaan, or where Canaanites dwelt. So that's where he was, a particular piece of land. Verse 7, then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your descendants I will give, what? This land. Doesn't sound like the world, does it? I will give this land. Now drop on, skip on over to chapter 13 and verse 14. And this is after quite a bit had happened. Abram found himself in Egypt. He eventually made his way back to the land. Now in verse 14, and the Lord said to Abram, after Lot had separated from him, lift up now your eyes and look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward, for all the land which you see I give to you and your descendants forever. And I will make your descendants as the dust of the earth, so that if a man could number the dust of the earth, then your descendants also could be numbered. Arise, walk in the land through its length and its width, for I give it to you. I don't think he was walking across a continent, was he? No, he was walking across a particular piece of land. We call it the promised land, or land of promise. And then in chapter 15, look at verse 18, he becomes very specific here. It says, on the same day the Lord made the covenant with Abram, saying, to your descendants I have given this land from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates, the Kenites and the Kenizzites and the Kadmonites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Rephaim, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Girgashites, the Jebusites, the Perizzites, and any other sites. So he gives this land. Now, that doesn't sound like the world, does it? It's a specific piece of land. Now, there's some controversy among some as to what the promise here really entails. If you look at the image, I have an image here of the, there it is. That's during the time of the Empire of David and Solomon. You see the area that's encircled with red. It has the red border around it. That was the land at that time. That's what Israel possessed. That's not a very large piece of land if you were to step back and look at the whole region, is it? No, it's not. That's a fairly narrow strip. It's on the it's near the Mediterranean along the shore, except for Phoenicia and the Philistines, the land that they occupied. But it runs up and down the western part of on the western side of the Mediterranean. And so you see that it goes, it says here in the text, it says that it was from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates. Now in this, you will notice at the very top, you see where the Euphrates dips down. So the land goes all the way up to the Euphrates up there in the north, and then down at the bottom you have, it doesn't name it, I don't think, but it's the brook of Egypt. Some people think it means the Nile River. Others say, no, it's talking about the brook of Egypt, not the Nile River. That's also known as Wadi El Arish. Wadi El Arish is a stream that's there. So many people say, well, that is the land that was promised. But others say, oh, no, that is the land that was initially settled, but they didn't settle the entire region that was promised originally to Abraham. I'm not going to make the argument one way or the other, but don't have any problem with it either way. But there's another map I have that shows the broader region. Now some say that this is the land of promise. You see along the shoreline there of the Mediterranean Sea, that's where that little thin line of, well, it's where Israel, that's where the previous illustration that you saw, the previous map that you saw, that's where the land of Israel is. That's where the Holy Land is today. Just a very small piece of land. But many claim that the original promise here, that really this river of Egypt was the Nile River, and the Euphrates is not merely the place up at the top that where the Euphrates dips down a little bit, but in the whole Euphrates, that's the line. It runs right through the heart of Iraq. So that's a significant piece of land there, and you've noticed a lot of it there takes in some desert land. You're reminded of the prophecies about the flower blooming in the desert and so on, and the idea being that once God blesses the people and multiplies them, they'll inhabit that, they'll help take in that whole land, and it'll become very fertile. Okay, we can debate that back and forth. You can accept it or not. That's not my point today. But my point is that that's not the world, is it? In fact, if you step back and looked at the globe, there's the image here, and put a magnifying glass over the whole region and took a look at where it says Turkey, Syria, Jordan, you see where Israel is right in there, don't you? I don't think you can read the word Israel, but you know where Israel is, right there next to the Mediterranean. And even if you have the larger part that goes over to Iraq and runs along the, if the border runs along the Euphrates River, it's still a kind of a small section, segment of that whole region there, isn't it? And one thing for sure, it's not the world, is it? And yet here we see that Paul is saying Abraham is heir of the world. How do you get that? Well, it's an interesting story. I'd like to use an illustration. Some of you are novel readers. You read series of novels. Most of us who don't like to read watch it on television or go to the movies to see it. But you know how in movies or in television series, especially those that go from season to season to season, and also in novels, that how there are little details along the way, and if you want the end of the book or the end of the movie or the series to make sense, if you want to get the most out of it, then you need to pay attention to the details, don't you? Now, fortunately, let me ask, how many Star Wars fans do we have in here? Is that all? What's wrong with you people? I see you don't appreciate the finer arts. No, but for those of you who do appreciate the arts and are more culturally refined, I'll tell you a little bit about Star Wars. It was back in the 70s. I was already an adult when the first one came out. It was episode 4, though. They began with episode 4. Had 4, 5, 6, that's the trilogy. And then a long time later, they came out with the episode 1, and then episode 2, and episode 3. So we began late in the story, fairly late in the story. We began, and right off, just a few moments after the introduction, we were introduced to this very dark figure, you know, this deep booming voice, Lion King voice, you know. Yeah. And also the obviously some kind of breathing apparatus going on there that is all mysterious and dark, you know. And of course, I'm talking about Darth Vader. Anybody don't know who I'm talking about? You don't know? Okay, I think everybody is familiar with the character, even if you haven't seen the movies. But in any case, here's this guy. He's obviously dreadfully evil. He's kind of scary. Everybody fears him. And he wears the mask and has the breathing apparatus. And you start to pick up a little information about him as the movie progresses. That you learn that that he is more machine than man now. You think, what's going on with that? What's happened to him that's now made him more machine than man? He was seduced by the dark side. And we're told at first that he killed Anakin Skywalker, but later we find out, no. He is Anakin Skywalker. That was his name. That's who he was. He was a Jedi at one point. You do know what Jedis are, don't you? Okay. But anyway, he was a Jedi, meaning he was one of the good guys, but he was seduced by the dark side, by an evil emperor, and became his ally. Okay. So you learn about Darth Vader. Then along the way, you find out he's Luke Skywalker, who's the hero in the parts 4, 5, and 6, you learn that's his father. And then you learn that Leia, Princess Leia, is Luke's sister. So it all unfolds and is very interesting. And then comes years later, you see episode 1, and you're introduced to Anakin Skywalker as a very small, cute little boy. And they even call him Annie. And you think, no, that doesn't fit. Annie. There's cute little Annie. One day, this guy is going to kill more men than Cecil B. DeMille's. That's a lot of killing. And you see how important it is if you're at the end of the story, you've got the end of the story, now you go back and you can look at those details. If you didn't have all the details you got or all the information from the end of the story, you wouldn't be able to read what's going on there quite as well, would you? For example, when you see Anakin Skywalker more and more giving in to certain feelings and more allowing his emotional attachments to control him, even though he's been warned that that's a sure path to the dark side. And so you wouldn't probably know anything that much about it had you not already seen the end of the story. Similarly, in the series The Walking Dead, some of you are familiar with that. This is a post-apocalyptic world. And if you don't follow those details very carefully, then you're going to miss something along the way. For example, this fellow named Morgan, who was once given to his, the beast that rages within because of the things that had happened to him in this horribly gone wrong world. And he became very violent and dangerous, but someone put him in a little prison along the way someplace, a little in-home jail cell, and began to teach him how to take control of the beast within. And he became a lover of peace, and he became a respecter of life. And so he just transformed his that old beast within into something very different. And then you find later, when he is in this place called Alexandria, he's building a little jail cell inside the home, similar to the one that he was in. Now, we haven't gotten to the end of the story yet, but I'll guarantee you they didn't just throw that in there in order to take up time. Now, that cell is going to be used for something, and I'm hoping that Negan, you know, he's the current bad guy. I hope he winds up in it. Very well might, but in any case, here's what happens. As we look at the details and little side episodes along the way, another side episode is when one of the characters accidentally found another group. There's several groups there. Another group, all women, way out in the woods, hidden away from everybody else, and they are extremely well armed. Meantime, the people in Alexandria, another place called the Kingdom, another place called the Hilltop, they're going to wage war against Negan and the Saviors, who are the bad guys. And the only thing is, they don't have any weapons. Guess where they're going to get them? Well, you already figure that out, don't you? So you can think it through ahead of time. But sometimes when people get together and say, well, I think this is going to happen, that's going to happen, and people come up with these different scenarios, it could go all kinds of different ways. Well, that's the way it is with Scripture. We look at the Old Testament, we see the promises given to Abraham, we see them unfolding and developing along the way, and then when we get together, if we don't have the rest of the story, if we don't have the final revelation, then what we begin to do is say, well, I think it's going this way, or it'll go that way, it'll go the other way, this is how Messiah will come, and when he comes, this is what he's going to do. In fact, they all got it wrong when he did come, but that's what we do. But now, once you have the rest of the story, once you have the final revelation, you're able to look back at the details and the side episodes, if you want to call them that, the subplots, and you can begin to see truth in them that you couldn't see before. And that's what we have going on here, and that's how the Apostle Paul, see, he knows that the saints will inherit the earth, the world. They will judge the world. He knows this because he has the end of the story. He has and I'm not saying the story ended with the time of Paul. It's still much to go on, but the end of the story, meaning the Christ event brings in the final chapter. So Paul has the final chapter, and he sees it. Now he can look back at previous revelation, and he can see all of this, these wonderful, marvelous things emerge from it. So look at chapter 12 again, Genesis 12, a couple of scriptures I want to point to here. Genesis 12 and verse 3, remember this is after he says, first of all, he says, I'll show you a land, then he says, I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. Verse 3, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you, and, now get this, in you all the families of the earth, that's not just Jews, is it? Not just Israelites. All the families of the earth shall be blessed. Now you can read that and say, yeah, Israel's going to become a great nation. They're going to teach the other nations how to serve God and worship God, and they'll be blessed in that way. Well, that's one scenario, but Paul came to something different because he has the rest of the story. He has the final revelation. Another scripture I want you to look at is chapter 17. Chapter 17. And the first five verses says, when Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am Almighty God, walk before me and be blameless. And I will make my covenant between me and you and will multiply you exceedingly. Then Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, as for me, behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be a father, get this, you shall be a father of many nations. Wait a minute. He just said he was going to make a great nation of him, and in him all the families of the earth would be blessed. Now he's telling him, you will be a father of many nations. How is that? Well, I've heard a lot of theories. I've heard a lot of different views expressed, but I know what Paul says about it. We'll get to that in just a few moments, because Paul has the last chapter, and he's able to look back at a scripture like this and see a truth emerge from it that otherwise would be very hard to grasp. So he says, I'll make you the father of many nations. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations. So hold to that thought. Hold to that thought. There's something in there that may not be on the surface. How is Abraham the father of many nations? We know he's the father of Israel, the Israel and Judah, is father of those nations. Ideally, that nation, one united nation. But here it says he's the father of many nations. We'll go back to Romans chapter 4, and let's look at what Paul says, keeping in mind that he has the final revelation. He knows the last chapter in the book. And Romans chapter 4, and let's begin in verse 8 and see how he refers back to this scripture and several others from the book of Genesis. In verse 8, Romans 4, verse 8, he's quoting the scripture that says, blessed is the man to whom the Lord shall not impute sin. He says in verse 9, does this blessedness then come upon the circumcised only, meaning the Jews, or upon the uncircumcised also? For we say that faith was accounted to Abraham for righteousness. How then was it accounted? While he was circumcised or uncircumcised? Not while he was circumcised, but while uncircumcised. So you see the argument that he's developing here. And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had had while still uncircumcised, that he might be the father, get this, he might be the father of all those who believe, though they are uncircumcised. Now you're beginning to see how Abraham could be the father of many nations and not just Israel, of all those who believe, that righteousness might be imputed to them also. And the father of circumcision to those who not only are of the circumcision, but who also walk in the steps of the faith which our father Abraham had while still uncircumcised. So the point here is that Abraham was justified. We read that back in Genesis, back in chapter 15, about how God declares Abraham righteous on the basis of his faith. It says Abraham believed God, and so he accounted it to him for righteousness. Now verse 13, again, this is the verse we begin with, for the promise that he would be heir of the world. You see how he's heir of the world? By being a father not only of Israel, not only the people who will dwell in that one land, but also the people that will dwell all over the world. Because the children of Abraham are the people who exhibit and have the faith of Abraham. That's what he's saying here. The promise would be to the that he would be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. So you don't have to first be a Jew. That's what he's saying. It's through the righteousness of faith. And there are many people coming to the faith the same way Abraham came approached God, in faith. Where if those who are of the law are heirs, faith is made void and the promise made of no effect, because the law brings about wrath, for where there is no law, there is no transgression. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be according to grace, to that promise, so that that promise might be sure to all the seed, or all the offspring, or all the descendants. Now, what's he talking about? What descendants? Who are the seed of Abraham? Those who are of faith. Not just Israel, not just Judah, but all who are of faith. So it's that way that he is the father of many nations. It is that way that he and his descendants are heirs of the world. But also to those who are of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all, whether you're Jew or whether you're Greek or whatever you are. As it is written, I have made, now get this, same scripture that we just read, I have made you a father of many nations. So you see what Paul, now that he has the last chapter, he knows the final word, and now he looks back at previous revelation and he's able to see deeper truths in it than he might have recognized before reading the end of the book, as it were. In the presence of him who believed, God who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. So, this is what Paul obviously, he goes on to say, who contrary to hope, in hope, believed so that he became the father of many nations according to what was spoken. And now he quotes another scripture, so shall your descendants be. Meaning, he's referring back to Genesis 15 and verse 5, where Abraham is told to look at the stars of heaven. Said, if you can count the stars of heaven, then you can count your descendants. That's how great your descendants will be. And Paul is here seeing a deeper truth in that. It's not just about Israel. It's not just about his physical descendants, but it's about all of those who are of faith. They are the descendants of Abraham. Now, there's some other things that come out of this. Look at Galatians 3, a couple of scriptures I want to refer to in winding this down. Galatians chapter 3 and verse 16. He says, now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. It says he does not say, and to seeds as of many, but as of one, and to your seed, who is Christ. Now, where does he get that? Where in the scriptures is there the singular seed of Abraham? And the answer is it's in Genesis chapter 17 and verse 19. It refers there to Isaac, but Paul here is seeing a deeper truth in this. That's the seed of Abraham, Isaac was, and so Christ is the ultimate seed, singular, of Abraham. So what's he saying here? Who is the descendant of Abraham? Well, it's Christ ultimately. So what is he saying? You want to know where Israel is? Israel before God? Christ is the new Israel. And if you are in Christ, you have that language in Scripture. Being in Christ speaks of relationship. And guess what that makes you? You're a part of that same body. But more than that, let's look over to verse 29. Says, and if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. What's the promise? Inheritance of the world, as we have seen. Not just that land of promise, but the whole world. Because the seed of Abraham are from all nations, not just the nation of Israel or of Judah. Now then, something else I want to call your attention to in 1 Corinthians 15. Having established that Christ, in a manner of speaking, is the new Israel, and that we can be joined to Christ and therefore be partakers of the promised to Israel. But more than that, look at 1 Corinthians 15. This is a theme we could develop further, but just to make the point briefly here, 1 Corinthians chapter 15 And look at verse 20. It says, "But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the firstfruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive, but each one in his own order." Here's the order: Christ the firstfruits, afterward those who are Christ at his coming. So that's the order. If you're in Christ, then you inherit what he has. You have immortal life, immortality as well. Skip to verse 45. "And so it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit." So what is this saying? The first Adam? That's Adam, the original. Who is the last Adam? That would be Christ. What it says right here. What is he saying? Who was Adam, first of all? That was humanity. God created humanity, humankind, in that one person, Adam. In fact, Eve was even in Adam at first, until she was taken out of Adam. And then all of us were in Adam. Everything that would make up you and me was in Adam. And here he's comparing, and he's saying that Christ is the last Adam. In other words, Christ is not only, as we see in Galatians, not only is he the new Israel, he is the new humanity, the new Adam. And if you are therefore joined to him, if you are in Christ, then you are part of the new creation. That's his point here. And I think also that some of the details that we find in the Gospels point to the larger picture, that Christ is not only Savior of Israel, but of other peoples of the earth as well. For example, you ever wondered why in the genealogy in Matthew that some women are named there, including names like Rahab and Ruth? Is there a message in there? I think there is. You see, Christ came not only from, he descended not only from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He has that Gentile, if you want to say it, if you want to call it that, mixed in. And I think there's a message there. What about the wise men from the east coming to worship the one born as king of the Jews? Is there a message in that? I think so. The statement, God is able to raise up seed to Abraham from these stones. Is there a little message in there? Is the writer including that because he wants to send a message about how wide God's, the extent of God's program, and who the seed of Abraham are? What about the faith of the Roman centurion who sought healing for his servant? Or the faith of the Syro-Phoenician woman who sought healing for her daughter? You see all these Gentiles popping up from here from time to time, and they have more faith than the natural-born Israelites. There's a message there, isn't there? There's a message there. Now, some modern critics accuse the writers of the New Testament of proof texting and lifting terms and phrases and whole statements out of context and applying them to Jesus. You can buy books on that subject and you see what they're trying to say there. But that's not what's going on. They're not proof texting. They may use some text to prove their point, but that's generally not what they're doing. That's not what Paul is doing here in Romans 4. They're beginning at the end of the story. They're beginning with the fullness of divine revelation as it has come to light through Jesus Christ. And now they're able to look at previous revelation through fully focused Christological lenses and see how all the details and the subplots come together to tell the wonderful story of how God is bringing humankind into full fellowship with himself and how he has made us with Christ, heirs of the world.